All right, Hard Rockology Show, Chris, Matt, and Jason back in with you. That's the title track from Black Star Riders. The song is called Bound for Glory. And on our phone, I want to welcome Ricky Warwick, vocalist, guitarist of the band. Ricky, welcome to the Hard Rockology Show.
Hey, how are you guys doing? Thanks for having me on the show.
Doing great, doing great. How about you?
Very good, thank you. Really good.
Now, Ricky, first off, I want to say congratulations. I know Black Star Riders' album's been out for a while, but when I say congratulations, I want to say I know later this year you got a couple solo albums that you're putting together with Joe Elliot from Def Leppard, and it was kind of like one of those, you know, looking for sponsors or basically, you know, let's raise the money for this thing. And I noticed today that you reached your goal and that these albums are going to be coming out a little bit later on this year, so I want to say congratulations on that.
And, thank you very much.
Yeah, so, but we'll touch base with that a little bit later on. But first, let's talk a little bit about Black Star Riders. And sure. I guess the first question is, I know originally you were in the band and you guys were touring as, I guess, the new version of Thin Lizzy. And some talks came about and you guys were planning on, you know what, why don't we just go ahead and write some new material and release it as maybe a new Thin Lizzy album and all that. And so why don't you go ahead and tell us exactly what happened, because I know originally you had some of the original members from Thin Lizzy still in the band, and then basically you started going into the studio and morphed into what is now Black Star Riders.
Okay, so yeah, the lineup with Thin Lizzy, we've been touring for about 2.5 years, and you had Brian Downey, original drummer, founder member, started the band with Phil back in 1968, believe it or not. Scott Gorham, obviously, the legend that is, he joined the band in 74. And was obviously been a mainstay ever since. Darren Wharton on keyboards, who was in, I think he joined on Chinatown album in 79-80. So those are the three original members, and then obviously myself singing, Marco Mendoza on bass guitar, and Damon Johnson on lead guitar. And we've been through it, it's been going great, we've been getting rave reviews, the shows have been fantastic, and just the natural thing felt that we wanted to do, we felt we just wanted to write some new material. And that came together really quickly, and the demos that we did, we were very happy with and sounded good, and resulted in us getting a lot of label interest. We were progressing along, and we had every intention, I think, of putting the album out under the Thin Lizzy moniker. But so the time we're on, and it's getting near the album recording deadline, there was definitely this white elephant in the room that were, hang on a minute, this is the first Lizzy album in 30 years. Without Phil Lynott, there'll be the only Lizzy album without Phil Lynott on it. You know, is this a step too far? And I think we all felt that in our hearts, that, you know, we should let the history be history, respect the past. I mean, playing those wonderful songs live is one thing, but actually recording an album without Phil, I think, as a fan myself, I think, I just thought it was, you know, it just felt like it was too much on a personal level, and as a fan level as well. So Scott actually came in and brought it up and said he was feeling uncomfortable with doing it under the Thin Lizzy moniker, and it was relief. We were all like, you know, I'm glad you said that, because we were kind of thinking the same thing. And, you know, as a fan myself, if somebody said to me Lizzy were making an album without Phil, honestly and truly, I would have been pretty horrified, to be honest with you. So, you know, that was addressed, and then when that came to a head, Brian and Darren, you know, said, look, you know, why don't you, if you guys are going to carry on and change the name, there's a lot of touring involved, we already feel like we're on the road too much, there's a lot of promo with a new album, it's just not really for us, you know, we don't want to spend 6-7 months away from home anymore. So they stepped aside, so we continued on with myself, Marco Mendoza, Damon Johnson, and Scott Gorham as Black Star Riders, and we brought in Jimmy DeGrasso on drums, and that was solidified the Black Star Riders lineup.
Now, I do have a question for you, because there's a lot of bands that have come and gone since, unfortunately, Phil's passed away, claiming to be the next incarnation of Thin Lizzy or carrying the torch. And both my brother and I are huge fans of Thin Lizzy. And Phil had a style of singing and writing lyrics that, for me, is what made Phil Lynott. And I will say this, the fact, listening to this album, I don't know what it is or how you went about doing this, because I've heard you on The Almighty. And your style of writing and singing is completely different. Was that a conscious effort on your part to be more like Phil in the way he wrote and the style that he wrote? Because I'm going to say this. Out of all the artists I've seen out there that are covering Thin Lizzy or trying to cover Thin Lizzy, you got Thin Lizzy, you got Phil Lynott in the way he was writing his songs.
Oh, man, thank you very much. Honestly, really cool of you to say that. You know, being Irish, kid growing up in Belfast, Lizzy was the soundtrack of my youth. I mean, I idolized the band, and they were everything to me. And Phil has always been an inspiration. But, you know, when Scott called me up and said, do you want to join the band? And, you know, obviously I jumped at the chance. You know, suddenly you're faced with, well, how am I going to do this? You know, Phil is so iconic. He's such an amazing frontman, probably, in my opinion, the best in the world. He's such a great, you know, he has his own unique way of singing. And, you know, I knew a lot of those Lizzy songs, and I'd always, you know, loved how Phil delivered songs. Even though The Almighty, like you said, was very, very different. I mean, some of my solo stuff, Phil was obviously a very big influence in some of the solo records that I put out. But I wanted to sing those songs the way we all know and love them. I didn't want to change a thing. I wanted to try and get as close to the original Thin Lizzy sound as I could, obviously while, you know, retaining my own identity. And that's what I tried to do. So when the natural progression was to evolve in Black Star Riders, you know, I kind of stuck with it. I mean, you've got to remember, I've been singing those songs day in, day out for 3 years. I've been, you know, even though Phil's in long words, I felt like I knew the guy because, I was singing his lyrics, I was reading stuff about him. You know, I met with his mom, I was talking to his mom, you know, and I always make a kind of joke about it, but I've never learned so much from a dead guy in my life, and I mean that with all the greatest respect. I mean, Phil has taught me so much as a musician, as a performer over the last 3.5 years, just from playing his songs every night. So, consciously, you know, I knew with Black Star Riders, I wanted to retain, you know, as much of that in the writing as I could. It just seemed like the logical thing to do and the right thing to do.
Yeah, the album is amazingly, for Thin Lizzy fans, they're going to love this album. If they don't already have it, I mean, they should pick it up right away if you're a big Thin Lizzy fan. But the amazing thing is you guys recorded this in 12 days with producer Kevin Shirley, right? And I mean, how did that go about? And I know you guys mentioned that you'll never do that again, but I mean, what was the experience like recording something like in 12 days compared to like months on end?
You know, Kevin's an amazing producer. Obviously, his work speaks for himself, but he likes to work at the speed of sound, and you've got to have your stuff together. You've got to know your songs inside out. Everything is done live. There's no, you know, okay, that was a good drum and bass take. We'll keep that. We'll put the guitars, and we'll spend, you know, 3 or 4 days doing the guitars, and we'll do the vocal bass. None of that. Every song, the time we did a take, it was with a full band, the way we'd set up in rehearsals, you know, all facing each other, and everything was kept. There was very few overdubs. A couple of, like, dual lead guitar bits, bit of backing vocals. Those were the only overdubs. And it was weird, you know. None of us had ever recorded that fast, and it was literally a song a day. And I think the fact that we knew the songs so well and we demoed them so well, it obviously was, we were able to do that. But, you know, and I think the album sounds great, but would I like to work that way again? Personally, me, no, because I think a couple of songs, I think, suffered from being recorded that quickly. You know, I think there's a couple of songs that needed a bit more TLC. I think some of them maybe benefited from a song like Bound for Glory. Absolutely captured the vibe and the energy of putting that sucker down live the way we did. So there's pros and cons with it, but I mean, it'd been really nice just to, on a personal level, just to have another 5 or 6 days in the studio just to gloss over some things. But, you know, the record's done really well for us, and it sounds great, and people are happy, so, you know, what do I know?
Well, that being said, I know you guys are going back in the studio. I know you got some more shows coming up here in the States and possibly going abroad for a little bit. And then You guys are heading back into the studio to have, produce the next album, which I guess Joe Elliott's going to be involved with there. So is he going to be producing that album? Is Shirley coming back for the next one?
Absolutely, yeah. Yep, Joe's going to produce the next Black Star Riders album. Joe's been a big supporter. I mean, Joe was very instrumental in when Lizzy got back together. Obviously, you know, myself getting the gig, and obviously Vivian Campbell did the first couple of tours with us as well while the Lips were off the road. And Joe has done a lot of the remastered Lizzy stuff that's just come out on Universal. Joe's been involved with that, so he's been a big champion of the band and is a huge fan. And he just offered his services, and, you know, when somebody's sold 90 million records and has the experience that Joe has, it's hard to turn that down, and he's such a great guy. And such a champion of rock and roll. We really wanted to work with him. He really wanted to work with us. He's got a great studio in Dublin, and no better place to record the next album. And just, you know, all the ducks kind of lined up, and it's just the right way to go.
So is it fair to say that most of the new album's already written, or are you guys still putting together some tracks?
No, we're still working on it, and the plan is to, you know, we've got about we've probably got 10, 11 songs that are sort of finished. I was down in Nashville a couple of weeks ago. Our guitar player, Damon Johnson, lives there, so we were working on stuff down there. And it's coming together, but over the summer we'll get another 8 or 9 songs together before we start in October.
Ricky, you got a favorite song off the new album?
Yeah, you know, it changes all the time. I mean, I think Kingdom of the Lost, just because of obviously the Celtic Irish feel to it, it was a real triumph writing that one. I mean, Damon and I spent a lot of time in that song, and I'm really pleased with how it turned out. So I guess if I had to pick one, it would be Kingdom of the Lost.
Scott Gorham give you a lot of stories about Thin Lizzy, or did you ask him a lot about Thin Lizzy, or did you pick his mind when he's in the band with you now? I mean, just a million stories about Thin Lizzy.
Oh, listen, he's the original badass of rock and roll. You know, don't look any further. He's the real deal, and him and Phil terrorized everywhere they went back in the day, and there's some amazing stories about what the two of them got up to. I'm with Brian Robertson as well. They definitely were, you know, the last gang in town, it's great. I mean, Scott couldn't tell you what he did yesterday, but he can tell you what he did, you know, 30 years ago and to the day and the date and where he was and stuff like that. So I never get tired of hearing those stories and what, you know, they were just the real deal. They just were.
Yeah, interesting band to read about, and just a lot of tough breaks that they had in the 70s. I mean, with Brian Robertson getting his hand messed up, and with Phil getting
Gary obviously going AWOL a couple of times, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And then thank God they had Brian Downey on drums, you know. I mean, he was like
No, they just couldn't seem to catch a break in America. I think there was something that's always, I think, annoyed Scott to this day, was that Jailbreak was starting to get a lot of radio play and starting to sell really well. Obviously, Boys Are Back in Town made a huge hit off that. And, you know, the injury with Brian and everything, and they just couldn't really capitalize on it. And I think it still sticks in Scott's craw to this day, you know.
So with the Black Star Rider set, you're playing pretty much the whole album, I guess, and you're going to obviously throw in some Thin Lizzy songs. I mean, how do you guys decide with Thin Lizzy songs? I mean, obviously,
you know,
Boys Are Back in Town.
It's pretty much 50-50. You know, it's pretty much half Black Star Riders, half Lizzy. And there's Lizzy songs you have to play. And that's okay, because we love playing them. I mean, you've got to play the Boys Are Back, the Jailbreaks, you know, the Emeralds, Cowboy song. People expect and demand to hear those songs, and rightly so. So, you know, there's not that much room once you've thrown in sort of 8 or 9 Black Star Rider songs for too much else. Basically, we're playing all the classics from the Lizzy catalog. I mean, there's a couple of, you know, swerve balls in there as well now and again.
All right, now we're going to go off a little bit from Black Star Riders, because I really want to ask you about your two new solo albums, because, like I mentioned earlier, you're actually doing something fairly unique. You're actually not doing just one, you're doing two of them. The first one being Hearts on Trees, which is going to be a completely acoustic album, which I'm looking forward to hearing. And, of course, the second one, When Patsy Cline Was Crazy and Guy Mitchell Sang the Blues, is going to be a hard rock type of album. So, I mean, what was the idea behind these two albums? Was this something that you've been working on for a while now? Because
it is, you know, and it's something that I started just before I got off with the Lizzy gig. And obviously, you know, Lizzy took priority. But when there's been downtime or I've been at home, it's something I've just been chipping away at and working away. Both albums are written with a really good friend of mine from Belfast called Sam Robinson, who's just a buddy of mine. And we just, literally, I was back home in Belfast for Christmas about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, sitting in the pub, and, you know, we were just talking about ideas we had and growing up in Belfast. And Sam has a great way with words. He sent me some lyrics, and I sent them back to him. I added some, and just it went like that, backwards and forwards. And before we knew it, we'd sort of 20 songs, and we decided we'd divide them into, 10 would be electric and 10 would be acoustic, and that's what we've done. So the album's been sort of written and pieced together over the last 4 years.
Now, the acoustic songs, I mean, you just said that you picked what ones you wanted to do acoustic and which ones you wanted to do electric. Now, is it fair to say when you go on the road and you tour, you might switch that up a little bit? Maybe something that was electric?
Yeah, it's just the dictates what I'm going off. I'm going out solo acoustic, you know, that sort of changes everything. It dictates what I can play. I mean, most of the electric songs work really well on the acoustic guitar, and I guess vice versa. And obviously, I'm going out with the band. It would be nice to, I think the idea is hopefully to go out and do the acoustic album and then bring the band on and do the electric one. That would be the ideal situation.
Yeah, because I'm assuming when you're writing your songs, you're probably doing it on acoustic guitar, I'm assuming, most of the time.
Yeah, pretty much everything's written on acoustic, yeah.
Yeah, you get two albums there, right, Matt?
Two
albums.
You get
acoustic and you get electric.
Well, I mean, we're going to get a brand new Black Star Riders, and we're going to get two albums on from Ricky. So I'm
and then Ricky's bringing Phil back to life, and it's awesome. It's just an awesome time to really be, like, checking out Black Star Riders. So what's the fan reaction been? You guys played over in Europe a lot. Not so much the States too much, but, I mean, what's the reaction been so far? The fans really digging it, or are they kind of, like, really hesitant saying it's like, oh, they just sound like Thin Lizzy?
We just did a huge 9-week run right up from October right up to Christmas there in Europe, and it was an amazing reaction. Really, really good. We did some of the big festival. We did the Download Festival back in the summer in the UK, which was great. And now we're just going to start some shows. And end of April, we're doing a few with Skid Row in the States. And we're going over to Japan, down in South America, and then hopefully some more U.S. shows as well before we get into the studio to do the new one. You know, we're hopefully still trying that we might get on one of the big U.S. tours that's going out in the summer. That would be great. But if not, we'll just do our own club headline shows.
So if you had to put, like, a couple of your Thin Lizzy albums, your favorite ones, which ones would they be?
Probably Back Black Rose would be top of the list. Just, Gary's guitar playing with Scott on that, I think, is just phenomenal. And there's some great songs on that record. Do Anything You Want To is the first track on there. I've actually got the lyrics of the first verse that I tattooed on my leg.
That's a diehard fan right there, typing the lyrics.
One song that I always loved, Lizzy's song I always loved. I just thought it was great, and just the sentiment of it, and Phil's rhyming and his lyrics on it just blew me away. And when I actually got the gig, that was one of the first things I'd done. I just got the first verse tattooed on that, because obviously there was a lot of naysayers going, oh, you shouldn't be doing this and blah, blah, blah. And I was kind of going, read Phil's first verse of that song, you know, there's your answer right in there, and it's why I should be doing it, you know. And so I went and got the first verse tattooed on my leg. But obviously, that's a great album. I love the Fighting album as well. I love the song Wild One, and Borderline,
a
great tracks as well. There's not really a Lizzy album I don't even, there's a Lizzy song that I don't like. I mean, I'll go all the way back to, you know, the Vagabonds and stuff like that, and, you know, stuff like, even like Philomena and Little Darling and all those great songs as well.
Yeah, the Black Rose album is a really fantastic album. Got to Give It Up is a great song. You guys play that song?
No, you know, it's hard. For some reason, Scotty won't do it. And we're like, you know, it's just, I don't know. You know, it's just some songs. I don't want to play that one. I'm like, yeah, but dude, you may be sick of playing it, but, you know, we're not, you know? So,
Yeah,
I'm still working on him to play that one. We would love to play that one. Damon and I have been sort of harassing him to play that for a while now. It's such a great tune. But we do like Waiting for an Alibi and all that good stuff.
All right, so would you have any advice for, like, a musician up and coming? I mean, what advice would you give them?
You know, I'll be honest, it's always been a hard business. I just think it's really hard right now. There just isn't the record company support there anymore, and it's the market is so huge. Any you know, I hate to say it, any idiot can pick up a guitar and any idiot can make a record now, but you know, I still think there's got to be some kind of quality control, and I think you've just got to work hard, you know, listen to the great songwriters, listen to the great musicians, learn from them, practice, get into the garage, don't take the shortcuts that you can take online and stuff like that. Learn your craft, and then, you know, get your band out there, get your songs out there, get a good website, you know, use the media to your advantage, you know, be as interactive with the people that are into your band as you can, and spread the word as much as you can. I think that's all you can do.
That's good advice. So you've been in a lot of bands. You've been in the Almighty. You got your solo stuff,
yeah.
Black Star Riders, Thin Lizzy. You've had to have had some Spinal Tap moments on stage. You would you care to share a few with us?
Yeah, there's been everything from being hit with a ham and cheese sandwich to being on stage in Rome and somebody throwing Jesus Christ on a crucifix at me when I was in the Almighty and splitting my eye open. I had to get like 4 stitches in my eye during the gig, to obviously falling off the drum riser one night. I actually did a solo gig in Nottingham in a place called Rock City just last year in the summer, and it was a torrential downpour. Believe it or not, in England of all places, because it never rains there, right?
Oh, no.
and the roof caved in. There's actually people inside the venue watching me under umbrellas, which was kind of bizarre. So, yeah, you know, stuff like that happens all the time.
Okay, so Matt, you got anything else you want to add?
Well, I
got
to ask him. He said he had a ham and cheese sandwich thrown on him. Did you pick it up?
Oh,
and
right,
eat?
Yeah.
Did you pick it up and eat it, or what'd you do with it?
No, you know, it's one of those things where it hit my guitar strings. It was when I was in the Almighty, and I just thought of all the things to throw at an Almighty gig, because, you know, there'd be beer flying around and spit and carnage and people stage diving and shoes and bodies left, right, and center. But like a ham and cheese sandwich, I was just like,
yeah, who came up with
wow.
that?
Yeah, I'm like, I don't think I've ever been to a concert where I could get a ham and cheese
yeah.
sandwich.
Yeah,
right. I know. It was just one of those things where you're going, I looked down and went, really? You know, is that the, you know, of all the things you could have thrown, you threw a ham and cheese sandwich. Wow. I'm sure there's some hidden meaning behind it, and I just completely went over my head, but who knows.
All right, Ricky. So where can people find out about Black Star Riders, and what do you got coming up in the next couple of months?
So blackstarriders.com, you know, go on Facebook, we're on there, and blackstarriders on Twitter, and just type in the name, all that good stuff will come up. We are hitting the road in the U.S. for a bunch of dates, starting May 1st, with some of them with Skid Row, a few of them are headlining ourselves. Then we go to Japan, we come back, and then I think we do some East Coast shows in the States, but over to Europe for the festivals for the summer, if we're not on a, like I said, hoping to get on a U.S. tour, that will obviously change everything. But then we get into the fall, and we go over to Dublin to start work on the follow-up record with Joe Elliot.
Yeah, you should talk to Joe Elliot about, hey, put us on that Kiss tour, you know?
That would be nice. That would be nice. You know, it's funny, I was with Joe last night. Joe was here last night, and we were hanging out. So, you know,
that
would be very, very nice.
That would be really cool. I mean, because I don't know. I was like thinking of awesome lineups. You know, I mean, obviously Kiss, Def
sure.
Leppard. I mean, what? I mean, I'd love to see like a Black Sabbath and Deep Purple tour or something like that.
Sure.
I mean, but I mean,
sure, that'd be cool.
Yeah, but Black Star Riders opening up for Kiss and Def Leppard, that'd be awesome.
I'd go
you
see.
You know,
that.
It'd be nice. You know, and I never try to abuse Joe's friendship, and you know, he's always got my back and the band's back. So I know if there's anything that can be done, he's always always going out the bat for us. So it would be nice, you know, but. Like I said, there's a few tours going out that we're trying to chase, and we'll see what happens. If not, we'll do the festivals in Europe and regroup for the album in October.
All right, too. Now, if anybody wants to find out some more about your solo albums, is there a website or a place they can find out about that as
yeah,
well, too?
Yeah, again, just go to rickywarwick.com, and all the information for the pledge campaign is on there for the two albums, and you can still pledge. I mean, it's only, I think it's like $12 for a download for both albums of 20 songs for $12, which is kind of hard to beat. And there's obviously this vinyl that you can buy and all kinds of good stuff, t-shirts and stuff that you can get on there as well.
All right, Ricky, I want to thank you for coming on the Hard Rockology Show, like we do with all of our guests. Why don't you go ahead and introduce another track off the Black Star Riders album and take us out of the segment.
Cool, thank you very much for having me. Okay, Ricky Warwick here from Black Star Riders. And this is a song from our debut album, All Hell Breaks Loose, and this track is entitled Kingdom of the Lost.